Good Night by Connor Patrick Evelich, loosely based on Yvain or The Night with the Lion. Interior Tavern, Day. Common folk and peasants fill a rowdy tavern. Men in crusty tunics drink cheap mead. A minstrel strums out an airy ballad on his lute. A shadow passes by the window. Metal on metal can be heard outside the drinking hole. A pair of boots stop just outside the door, and silence falls over the drunken commoners. The door swings open and reveals Sir Calogrenant, a schlubby knight with mud on his face, twigs in his hair, and a rusty, dented breastplate. His coat of arms, a head of cabbage, is crooked on his chest. The crowd immediately turns back to their own business, forgetting Sir Cal as quickly as he came into their lives. Cal hobbles into the tavern, sore and exhausted, and searches for an open seat. He plops down at the bar, and the barmaid approaches him.
What'll it be, lad?
It's Sir, actually.
Right, Sir. Now, what are you having?
I'll take a...
Cal eyes the menu carved into a wood plank, which reads mead and nothing else.
A mead, I suppose. One mead, please.
She slams a frothy mug in front of him, splashing a vague brown liquid onto his lap. A fly reclines in the foam.
Isn't there anything nicer? I am a knight, after all.
And I'm the queen.
No, really. Sir Calogrenant of the Round Table, son of Cline no Iden of Hen Ogled. Sir Cal, for short, if you like.
That's all a bunch of nonsense to me, boy. Rowan!
The crowd hushes as the minstrel, Rowan, ceases playing.
Know any tunes about a Sir Cal?
Sir Cal, actually.
Sir Dial.
Hi.
It's Cal.
Gal?
No, Cal.
Nah, I ain't got none about no Sir Pal.
He resumes playing. The barmaid walks away from Cal.
Night, now I've heard it all.
Cal chokes down a few drops of his mead before a stampede of hooves is heard outside. Dust is kicked up, blotting out the sun. It grows dark inside. Everybody goes silent. Cal looks to the frozen drinkers. The shrill sound of spurs rings out. The door is thrown open, and in a beam of blinding light, a massive silhouette lumbers into the center of the room. Lord Esclados the Red stands well over 6 feet tall, suited head to toe in jagged pitch black armor. A blood-red cape drapes over his shoulders. He removes his helmet. Beneath the demonic visor is a draconian but handsome man, eyes black as the night.
Everybody out, now!
The entire population bolts for the door, swarming past the lord as they exit. Cal sits in bewilderment. Esclados seats himself at the head of the largest table. A dozen liegemen in similarly adorned armor enter and sit at the table around him.
Minstrel, sing something.
Of course, my lord.
Rowan jumps to attention and begins a jaunty melody. The barmaid places a mug in front of each man.
I'm so sorry, my lord. If I'd known you were coming, I'd have cleared the place right out hours ago.
And yet, you still serve my men this swill.
He smacks a mug from the table and it crashes into Rowan, who powers through with his ballad.
My lady joins me this day, and this is the best you offer.
Your lady?
A crier enters, his knees shaking as he screeches out,
Presenting Lady Laudine, the Dame of Landuk, Bride of Lord Esclados the Red, Protector of the Fount of...
A trumpet blares, cutting him off, and Lady Laudine enters. Her expression is severe. Surrounding her, maidens powder her face, hold her skirt, and guide her by the hand. As she sits next to her husband, the barmaid brings out a jug of fine wine and pours.
And what brings the good Lord Esclados here today?
My lady wanted some strawberries. When the farmer wouldn't part with them for free, we raised his lands and sold his children to some Spanish slavers. Isn't that right, Buki?
That's right, Bubble Butt.
The two giggle. Cal, still unnoticed, tries to creep past the lord and his lady. A floorboard creaks beneath his step.
Hold on.
She bats away a powder puff and inspects the knight.
Oh, sorry, I was just leaving. I don't want to interrupt.
Husband? This knave was ogling my bosom.
Your bosom? What? I was not.
Are you calling my wife deceitful? Were you not perusing her ample bosom with your beady weasel eyes?
I definitely wasn't. Wait, weasel eyes?
By the honor of my wife, Lady Laudine, Dame of Laudine.
I already got her name from the guy just a moment ago.
Esclados stands. He towers over Cal.
I challenge you to a duel.
A duel? Wait a second,
Tavern, moments later. Cal now stands outside the tavern, a circle of cheering spectators surrounding him and Esclados.
Fight?
liegemen remove Escladus's cape from his shoulders and place a massive longsword in his hands. A squire slides the helmet onto his head.
Draw your sword so I may crush your frail bird bones.
My lord, I do not want any bones crushed. How about we just pretend this never happened? I never ogled any bosoms and go our separate ways.
Somebody for the crowd reaches for Cal's sword, draws it from its scabbard, and places it in his hands.
Let the duel between Esclados the Red, Lord of Landuk, and Sir Cal, and Sir Cal begin!
So that's how today's gonna be. My lord, can we just reconsider and backpack this all up to...
Esclados dashes towards Cal, moving incredibly fast for somebody his size. The knight rolls aside just in time and hops to his feet, sword at the ready.
Ha-ha!
He looks up. He is facing the wrong direction. Esclados kicks Cal in the back, sending him into the dirt. He brings his great sword down as Cal tries to block, but his chipped blade shatters upon impact. The sword continues its descent, caving in Cal's breastplate. Cal writhes around on the ground, gasping for air. Esclados crouches beside him and lifts his visor.
I was hoping to face a real knight today, not a boy playing dress-up.
He cackles as he spits in Cal's face.
Let's go. I've had my fill of common folk for the day.
Esclados and his men mount their horses. A maiden, Lunete, goes to Cal's side. She helps him remove the clasps of his crushed armor and, able to breathe again, he sucks in air.
That was very foolish, Sir Cal.
Lady, in case you missed all of that, I didn't want to fight the guy.
You're lucky my lord didn't kill you. He's done far worse over less.
She lifts Cal's tunics to inspect his chest.
Nothing serious. Some bruising, maybe a few broken ribs. Like I said, you're lucky.
Whatever.
Cal gets up and brushes off Lunete. He stands, his back to her.
He's just a big dummy jerk.
I'd be careful what you say. There's a reason people in these lands fear him.
Lunete, come along.
It'd be a shame to lose a good knight over a few hurt feelings.
Cal smiles. He turns to thank Lunete, but she is already gone. Dust flies into his face as Esclados and his caravan ride away, black banners flying high. Rowan approaches with his lute in hand.
You know, I have actually got one about Sir Cal. Esclados the Red passed through one fine day. When a lone loser Sir Cal came his way, they got in a bout and blows came to pass, which ended in Cal on his lone loser ass.
Sounds like a hit.
Cal walks off, dragging his breastplate behind him. Exterior tavern stable, continuous. Tied in the stable is Baron Camembert, Cal's steed. Camembert looks to be more than a few meals undurfed and a few years too old. Also, he's a donkey. Cal sighs. He pets Camembert's unkempt mane.
Lone loser Cal. His lone loser ass.
Cal unties the mule from the post and struggles to lift himself onto the saddle.
Come on, Camembert. Let's go home.
Begin travel montage. A. Country road. Cal and Camembert meander down a dirt road. Camembert is outpaced by a shriveled old peddler pulling a medicine cart. B. Village square. Cal asks for directions from a villager shoveling dung. The villager accidentally drops some onto Cal's boots. C. River. Camembert plops down next to a river and slurps up some water. Cal tries to spur him on, but he won't budge. D. Farm field. Cal plods through a grain field atop Cam, waving to some of the farmers.
Salutations, birdie!
Who the hell are you?
He slumps down in his saddle and keeps riding. E. Castle Bridge. On foot, he guides his mule over a crowded bridge leading to Camelot. Peasants bump him and yell to watch it as he crosses. End travel montage. Exterior, Camelot Gate, day. Cal arrives at a towering gated wall. Behind the iron bars stands the majestic Camelot, a picturesque castle with squires and servants bustling about. He waits for the gates to rise, but it never does.
Hello?
State your business.
From atop the wall, two guards pop their heads out and stare down at Cal.
Hi, I'd like to enter Camelot.
Only those on official royal business may enter.
They pop back down, gone.
But I am on official royal business. I'm a knight.
They pop back out.
A knight?
Yes.
Of the round table?
Yes, sir. Calgrenet.
You don't look like no knight.
I've been in and out of Camelot dozens of times. Your name is Hale, and you're Otis.
The two guards whisper to one another, look Cal over, and whisper some more.
Describe it.
Describe what?
The round table.
Well, it's, wooden and round.
Shite. He's right. Well, got to learn it through, I suppose.
Gate opening!
The gate creaks open, and Cal sulks through with his lame steed in tow. Exterior Camelot stable, continuous. Cal tugs at Camembert's reins. They pass many a stately horse, each adorned with colors and seals of their respective knights. They continue well past these horses, deeper into the stable. Eventually, the stables turn to kennels, and hunting hounds howl as the lowly pair pass by. Reaching the last cage, Cal squeezes Camembert inside, tossing his trusty steed a carrot before closing the gate.
Gotta keep our strength up, Cam. Bon appetit.
Interior banquet hall evening. Hearty hollers echo through a packed hall, strapping knights and nobles feast below King Arthur, old with a massive beard. Cal enters through the huge double doors, expecting a knightly greeting. Nobody makes note of his entrance. He grabs the sleeve of a servant passing by.
Hey, could you just inform the guests that Sir Cal has returned from his quest?
Sure thing, my lord.
The servant scurries away, and Cal looks over the hall.
A noble knight's return from his quest.
A round of applause and cheering bursts forth from the crowd. Cal smiles and steps forward, taking a bow, but is bumped from behind and falls flat on his face. The bumper steps over the bumpee, oblivious. It is Sir Yvain, the perfect knight. He is tall, handsome, and muscular, with a killer smile and a perfect jawline. Ladies in waiting flock to his side as he strides past.
Sir Yvain, tell us of your quest.
Please, everybody. Good people, calm yourselves. I have traveled far and have a wicked thirst which needs slaying first. Huzzah!
But we're dying to know!
What great beast did you slay this time?
A knight, Sir Kay, hops from his bench. He is sly and wiry, a mischievous look permanently slapped on his face. Kay makes various phallic gestures as he taunts.
Ah, yes, Sir Yvain. Was it the Serpent of Sicily, the many-headed Hydra of Herculean legend, or perhaps the woodland nymphs and their satyr kin? Oh, I know, 'twas a woodpecker, yes?
Ah, Sir Kay, always the wicked tongue. 'Tis good to hear your jests again.
Kay rolls his eyes at Yvain's dense nobility and falls back into his seat.
But I shall tell, only because kind folks such as thyselves beg it of me. As you know, I'd set off in search of the vile questing beast from our good king's youth.
Cal dusts himself off as he enviously eyes the great knight. Exterior White Cliffs of Dover, earlier. Sir Yvain, in beautiful green and gold armor, rides his magnificent horse at full gallop atop the cliffs.
I tracked that foul creature for months, but lost its trail when an enchanting aria fell upon my ears.
Yvain hears singing, and in a stupor, follows the sound of the voices. Interior seaside cave, continuous. Torch in hand, Yvain makes his way through a murky cavern, nearing the singing.
After following this sweet melody, I discovered not one, not two, but three mischievous sirens.
Oh my goodness, that must have been terrifying.
Surely you can't be buying this.
Yvain bumps into three beautiful sirens, except they have tails and fangs and veiny wings. He falls into a love-struck trance. He steps over skeletons, picked clean.
Terrifying indeed, my lady. I was entranced by these demons, but as I'm sure you all know, no spell can hold my iron will for long.
The oohs and ahs of those listening to his story are heard. Yvain sits there, dumb, as the sirens caress his cheeks, ruffle his hair, lead him through a passageway. But he is just a tad too tall. He bumps his head on the cavern ceiling, bringing him out of his daze, and he draws his blade. In the shadow cast on the cave wall by the torch, we see him slice the sirens in two with one quick stroke. Interior banquet hall. People now sit around Yvain anywhere they can, including the floor, mesmerized. One lady-in-waiting rests her chin on his shoulder.
I rid the world of these terrible creatures, so they may never trick another poor fisherman again.
You're so good with your blade.
Alas, I did not find our good king's wretched beast, but I return with the treasure of the sirens, of Dover for Arthur!
Applause! A man standing next to Cal whispers to him.
I'm going to name my firstborn after Sir Yvain. Well, if the infant survives the plague, that is.
Cal turns to exit, but Sir Kay leaps onto a table and calls out to him. All eyes finally turn to Cal.
Who is that I spy? Sir Calogrenant? Clearly a greater case of nepotism there's never been.
Very funny, Kay. I'll see you later.
Nonsense! Are you not also returning from a noble quest? I'm sure maidens far and wide would love to hear it.
Kay makes a fat gesture with this comment.
Oh, I don't want to brag or anything.
My sweet cousin, please, do tell us of your grand exploits.
Grand. Well, I set out a few weeks ago in search of a vicious boar.
Vicious boar? I believe the farmer asked you to track down his lost suckling piglet. Wasn't that it?
Thank you, Sir Kay, for that. So the piglet. I tracked it for weeks, and...
This story is the real boar, am I right?
A ripple of weak laughs.
And I found it, and it had been eaten by a lion, so that's that. Well, see y'all later.
As Cal speaks, King Arthur's head begins to bob, the sweet call of a nap beckoning to him.
And no great reward for our king?
Surely you've brought some prize, cousin.
Well, no.
And no glorious victories, sweet Cal?
Oh, there must be something, sweet Cal.
No. Laugh it up, Kay. I know what you're getting at. You probably heard the song about me getting royally thrashed in the duel. Ha! 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 Everybody, Sir Caligrenant, the loser knight, had his rump roasted by Esclados the Red!
The entire banquet hall gasps. The silence is only broken up by King Arthur's snoring.
Esclados?
Yeah?
The Red?
Yes. That's what I said.
You don't mean Esclados the Yellow, notoriously known for how yellow he is.
Nope, I'm pretty sure it was red.
Cousin, Esclados the Red is among the cruelest lords in history. Very skilled with sword, spear, steed, and siege tactics.
I heard he's killed hundreds just for looking at him.
I heard he doesn't say please or thank you.
And worst of all, he never lets anybody go. Ever. He is merciless. So if you truly did duel Esclados the Red, why are you still here?
I don't know. He let me go.
Why?
Like I said, I don't know.
I don't believe you for one single second. You lie, sir.
Why do you know so much about him anyway? If nobody ever gets away, huh?
I'm from a vassal state, just a short jaunt from Broceliande. Duh.
Broccoli land?
Broceliande, cousin. 'Tis a forest, a mystical place which falls within Esclados' domain.
I don't know about any of that, but he beat me and let me go, so what?
Another gift you don't deserve, methinks. Fear not, gentle ladies. The brave Sir Cal has lived to quest another day.
The court laughs again, and Cal runs out of the banquet hall. Yvain sympathetically watches his cousin go, but is quickly pulled back into the festivities by the ladies in waiting. Exterior training yard, next morning. Knights and squires spar with wooden swords and practice dummies. Cal slinks through, trying to not be noticed, but his peers side-eye him, sneering and laughing. He finds the most distant, secluded dummy and begins to practice. Cal strikes once, and the dummy spins around, its wooden arm conking him in the back of the head. As he tumbles to the cobbled ground, the knights erupt into riotous laughter.
From a distance, one can hardly tell which is the knight and which is the dummy.
Cal looks up to see Kay standing over him, chomping on an apple. He gets up and brushes straw from his clothes. Kay leans on the dummy, his arm over the wooden man's shoulders.
But I'm glad you sorted that out for us.
Come on, Kay, I'm not in the...
As fond as I am of our times together, I'm here with a message. Yvain wants to see you in his chambers. Important night business. It should be interesting for you to finally be a part of some.
Kay struts off, tossing his apple core into Cal's hands.
See ya, sad sack.
Cal throws the core at the dummy. It bounces right back into his face.
You've got it out for me, don't you?
Interior Yvain's chambers. Later. The door slowly creaks open and Cal pokes his head in.
Yvain? You asked to see me?
He steps in, but his cousin is not in the exquisite room. It is filled with ornate furniture, taxidermy animals, and fine linens. The majestic green and gold armor of Yvain stands in the center of the room on a mannequin. It glistens, an angelic aura reflecting off of it. Cal is enchanted by it and steps closer to inspect. He rubs his hands over the fine craftsmanship, and his fingertips stop over the distinct seal in the center of a breastplate, a lion with a burning heart.
'Tis a symbol of great courage.
He spins around to see Yvain emerging from the next room, having just bathed. He is in all his naked glory.
Given to me by Queen Guinevere herself, for courageous acts in the service of our king. Your seal is a head of cabbage, yes?
The queen said it represented wholesome well-roundedness.
Cal tries to ignore his cousin's knighthood.
Something plagued me in my sleep, sweet baby cousin. And no, it wasn't the plague. This Esclados His reign of terror has gone on for years, and now? Wronging the king of Sir Yvain? Unforgivable.
Not again.
So I shall come to your defense. All damsels need a strong knight to fight on their behalf, so I shall be yours.
It's actually all good, Yvain. No skin off my back at all, so you really don't need to worry about it.
My mind is decided. I shall mount my steed, ride to the treacherous lord's keep with silver-tongued Sir Kay as my map, and defeat him in a duel for your honor.
Yvain mimes all of this, still nude.
Really, Yvain, it's...
Exterior courtyard, later.
Fine.
Too late. Yvain sits on his horse in full plate. The entire castle has assembled for the knight's departure.
Scribe, send a raven with a challenge for Esclados the Red. Tell him, Sir Yvain rides for your head.
He's good. He's saying exactly what the crowd wants to hear to get them screaming. The scribe scribbles this down, attaches it to a raven's leg, and tosses the bird into flight. A commoner next to Cal turns to him.
And how do you know the heroic knight? A fan like me?
Cal's had enough. He turns to stomp away just as Kay trots up on his horse to join Yvain.
Not coming to watch your valiant defender secure your honor? Oh, right. This is a real quest.
Kay reaches for his sword to draw, but produces a deadly sharp middle finger instead. Cal storms off as the crowd's cheers crescendo. Interior Cal's chamber, moments later. Cal's room is far smaller and less refined than Yvain's. It more closely resembles a closet. He tosses his dented breastplate into the wall and throws himself on the wood slab that is his bed. The cheers for his cousin are still audible. Faint voices outside his window draw him from his bed. Outside, Cal catches a glimpse of the two gate guards on the nearby castle wall.
Say, Vane's done some crazy stuff, but this quest takes a mutton.
No, it's doing same thing, so what?
You don't get it, Otis. You get a rude dude, Esclados the Red. He's officially the greatest knight of all time. Nobody be done with that.
Better than Lancelot.
Oh, they'll be making parody song and dance shows about Lancelot once Yvain does this, trust me.
A serious expression sets in on Cal's face. He grabs his saddle and runs from the room. Exterior Camelot gate, day. Servants are sweeping up the remnants of the big farewell to Yvain. Cal leads Camembert out the gate and across the bridge. Begin message montage. A, sky. Far above, amongst the clouds, the raven flies with Yvain's message tied to its leg. B, watchtower. It soars effortlessly through the air until it lands in a high tower. A watchman reads the message and his jaw dramatically drops.
A duel?
He quickly rolls the message up, ties it to a second raven, and throws it from the tower. C, swamp. The second raven lands in the middle of a swamp. A pimpled old crone quickly snatches the raven, bites its head off, and reads the message while she chews. She spits out her snack.
With a Esclados?
The hunched crone scampers over to her fire. She whispers an incantation into the flames.
That foley noli cannoli antonioni anoni.
A purple puff of smoke wafts high above the trees. D, university. A curious young student sits on the roof and gazes at the sky through a telescope. The purple smoke catches his eyes and he tears a piece of parchment from his book and begins scribbling onto it. He reads back his translation.
To the death?
The student rolls up the piece of parchment, slips it into an empty bottle, and drops it over the edge into the river below. E, river. The bottle bounces into the waves and off of rocks. It drops down a massive waterfall and rushes into a fish-filled net. A fisherman lifts the net from the river and notices the bottle amongst his bounty. He pops it open and reads it.
I don't know what the hell this says. I can't read.
F, mark it. A gutted fish slammed down onto cutting boards. The fisherman hawks his goods in a crowded marketplace. A cloaked figure eyes some trout, but notices the message in the bottle behind the counter and points to it.
That. Give it to me.
Ain't nothing but gibberish, scribblings, and dribblings.
Let me have it, and I suppose I'll buy some fish from you.
The fisherman hands it over, and the hooded figure reads the note inside. Removing her hood, sadness falls over Lunette's face.
Oh, no.
Still want the fish?
End message montage. Exterior road from Camelot, day. Yvain's horse trots down a dirt road. Kay drags behind, already sick of Yvain.
Good Kay, quicken your pace. We've much ground to cover.
Always the noble knight, my lord Yvain. I see you've polished your armor for this campaign.
Comrade, a clever play on words, one of which is my name. You are as skilled a wordsmith as the best blacksmith is skilled as a, what's the term?
A blacksmith.
Ah, yes, that's it.
K rolls his eyes.
Ah, this is the stuff knights are made of. Two strapping men riding stallions in search of tyrants to slay and maidens to lay.
Yeah, sure.
Yvain drops back to Kay's position. He slaps his companion on the shoulder vigorously.
They'll sing for us for decades. Sir Yvain and Kay, his sidekick. Now, we've a long day of travel, and...
He again pulls ahead, and the distance between them grows. Kay mimes stabbing himself with his sword. A long distance between the two knights, unbeknownst to them, Cal rides. They are specks in front of him. Interior, Esclados' throne room. Day. Lunete moves swiftly into a vast throne room. She clutches the rolled-up note. She comes to a halt as she nears the throne and drops to her knees.
My lord.
Esclados stands by his throne with a torture rack by his side. He cranks the device, which pulls in all directions the limbs of a peasant strapped upside down to the rack. The lord stops cranking and turns to Lunete.
What? What is it?
A message for you, my lord.
Give it to me.
He snatches the paper from her hand and reads it quickly. He begins chuckling.
A duel? Who does this Yvain think he is?
The name Yvain gets the attention of Lady Laudine, who lounges in her throne observing the torture session. She moves to her husband's side and reads over his shoulder.
I've heard of Yvain, a knight of Arthur's court, an impressive specimen, if the ballads are true.
A true knight. Let's hope this one is more fun than the last.
So you'll fight him?
I wouldn't miss it for my kingdom, Snugglebug.
The two stare lovingly into each other's eyes.
So, does that mean you'll let me go? I've got this terrible crick in my neck.
Lunete, leave us.
Tell the smith to make his repairs to my armor. I'll be needing it soon.
Yes, my lord.
Lunete picks herself up from the ground and rushes from the throne room. Lady Laudine places her hand atop Esclados' hand, still on the crank. They don't break their intimate eye contact as they crank together. The man's screams are heard off screen. Exterior roadside camp, night. Kay drops some twigs next to a fire pit.
Tell me again why we didn't bring any squires.
They'd only slow us down, Kay. Besides, I have you.
Yvain unrolls his sleeping mat. He glances over at the wood gathered.
You'll need to do better than that. When I get wood, I spring for nothing but the firmest laws.
Holy grail, man, do you listen to yourself? Of course, milord.
He lazily strolls back into the woods for more logs. Yvain walks over to the horse and begins to unpack his saddlebags. Hearing a twig snap, he spins around, but nobody's there. He reaches for his sword.
I fear no beast or man. Show you!
A log comes down hard atop Yvain's helmet. He freezes in place, not moving a muscle. Cal creeps up from around behind his cousin. He waves his hand in front of Yvain's face. He pushes him. Yvain wobbles back and forth before coming to rest in the same position. Yvain is knocked out, locked in place like a tin man.
Wow! That worked way better than I thought it would.
Cal looks at the sword in Yvain's stiff hand. He wrestles it from his knight's gauntlet and tumbles backwards into the dirt.
What in the name of Uther Pendragon is-
Cal scrambles to his feet and spins around with Yvain's sword, bringing the point to Kay's neck. Kay drops his logs.
What are you doing, Cal?
I'm not letting you two get all the glory for my quest.
Your quest? Last I checked, Esclados put you on your ass and rode off laughing.
Save it, Kay. I'm going after him myself.
Ah, of course. The bold Cal, noble numbskull of Arthur's round table.
Cal eyes Yvain, frozen in place.
Take his armor off.
What? No.
He prods the blade a bit into his friend's neck.
Take it off.
Kay slowly shuffles to Yvain and begins undoing the clasps.
Why?
Maybe Cal can't defeat Esclados the Red, but Sir Yvain certainly can.
You mean you're gonna take his armor and...
I think you mean...
Exterior roadside camp, later.
My armor.
Cal is now suited fully in Yvain's spectacular plate. Kay sits on the ground, hands and feet tied, next to a bound, unconscious Yvain.
You, passing as your cousin. That's a mummer's farce if I've ever heard one.
I don't care what you have to say, Kay. Besides, whoever shows up for the challenge has to be Yvain.
Cal sheaths the jeweled sword and mounts Camembert.
Wait, where are you going?
We just went over this. To find Esclados and cut his head off, or something totally badass like that.
Except you're forgetting an important step. Find Esclados. How do you plan on doing that?
Right.
Exterior road, later. Cal rides regally in his new armor. Draped atop the horse next to him is Kay, still tied up. The glow of Yvain's campfire fades in the background as they ride away. In the dark bushes along the road, eyes watch the two knights ride. A second set appears. The beady yellow pupils shift to the camp behind them and disappear. Exterior, wooded passage, morning. Camembert looks exhausted. His donkey face is drooping. Cal sees something ahead and pulls on the reins.
Whoa there, Cam!
The two knights come to a halt and Cal looks up. In front of them stands a 20-foot-tall giant with gray pallid skin, a mangy beard, and a patchwork of cowhides for clothes. He holds a spiked club in his hands. Kay struggles for his prone position to see the beast, who snorts a big, phlegmy snort.
What sort of creature are you?
What is it? I can't see.
The giant speaks with a slow, ponderous voice. He raises his club, ready to defend himself.
I am man.
A man? What sort of man?
Herdsman, I stand here. I did not let Cal come through.
Let me see. He sounds crazy.
Well, as you can see, we are not cows, but knights.
Knights?
Hardly.
On a quest.
Quest?
You can barely call it that.
The giant leans in close to Cal and sniffs. Camembert's legs shake.
Good night?
Not even close.
The best! Sir Yvain, a knight errant in search of justice. And my companion, Sir Kay.
Cal points to Kay, rump reared high atop his horse.
Oh, well that is good. Nice knight can go right through.
The giant steps aside and lets the knights ride past. As Kay's horse passes, he finally gets a look at the giant's monstrous features.
Oh, that's no man, unless men suddenly started looking like demon spawn.
What demon spawn?
Don't listen to
you,
him.
Buddy, a ghoulish lump of lard.
I'm man, not lard.
Okay, stop it.
Who put this dimwit in charge of anything?
Not dimwit, brightwit!
The giant's tears quickly shift into rage. He swats at Kay's horse, which sends the bound knight to the ground. Kay rolls over and looks up just as a massive club comes sailing down towards him. Cal leaps from Camembert and draws his sword, deflecting the blow. The club sinks into the dirt next to Kay.
You just had to open your bloody mouth.
Good night, not problem. Mean night is problem.
Sorry, but I need him alive, as much as it pains me to say.
The giant pushes Cal aside and stomps towards Kay, who is wriggling on the ground like a worm.
Hey, butt breath!
He stops his charge and turns to glare at Cal.
Yvain knight means who?
You better not come over here, you bag of bricks.
You problem now, too.
The giant picks up his club and marches back over to Cal. He swings, and Cal dodges behind a tree, which explodes into splinters.
Come on, jelly brains, gotta do better than that.
Brain solid, not preserved.
He swings again. Another shower of splinters. As Cal rolls to the ground, his, Yvain's, helmet falls off. Immediately, panic washes over him. He dives for the helmet and slips back into it just as the knight's palm connects, tossing him into a rock. Cal wobbles to his feet. The giant marches towards him.
Ooh, you're done now.
Not the time, Kay! Wait!
The giant halts mid-swing. Cal begins slowly circling the giant.
That's a great swing you got there, big guy. What are you lifting?
Just lift rock and spirits with nice lullaby.
Wow! I'd love to hear it someday.
Really? You hear a lullaby?
Cal looks up to the trees. He stops moving.
Nah, I'm only kidding. It'd probably sound like a screeching crow. Ha-ha!
The giant swings his club. Because of where Cal is positioned, the club catches a large branch which falls on top of the giant's head. He wobbles back and forth before falling on the ground. Lights out. Cal pulls off his helmet and rushes over to Kay, lifting him to his feet.
Thought that was the end of us both. I hate to say it, but well done.
I guess I'm not entirely devoid of surprises.
Cal looks down at the blazing lion on his chest. He smiles. Snapping back to reality, he hoists Kay back onto his horse and the two depart.
Really though, butt breath? Come on.
Interior troll cavern, same time. Flames crackle. A cauldron bubbles. Yvain groggily opens his eyes and looks up. He's hanging upside down, naked, tied to a spit, over a fire. Yvain examines his surroundings, a dark cave, a boiling stew, the broken iron bars of a dungeon littering the floor. Inside the cauldron, hooves bob up and down amidst turnips and potatoes.
Perfect, Sprock. This will make him taste far less foul.
Oh, but I like foul, Grock.
From shadow, two trolls, Grock and Sprock, emerge. They are short and fat, with rock-like ridges protruding from their backs. They possess the beady yellow eyes from earlier. Grock speaks very eloquently. He holds some rosemary.
No, Sprock, I don't mean chicken. I mean fowl, as in repulsive, disgusting, repugnant.
Oh, Master, I need you to say so, Grock.
I did, your earth. Now, let's get a decent braise going on this hide, okay, Sprock?
Okay, Grock.
Oh, haha! The good gentleman I've been looking for. I seem to be in a tight spot. Perhaps you could lower me from this rod and remove these bindings.
No, meat. Grock and Sprock will eat.
Yes, as I deducted. But I believe that's a mistake on your part.
A mistake? Care to elaborate on our blunder?
You see, I'm the great Sir Yvain on a quest for glory and honor. If I do not return, my brothers in arms will surely search for me, and you shall be met with a fate most, how did you put it? Ah, yes, foul.
You don't look like no knight, Grock.
My brother speaks true. You have no armor, no sword. What sort of a chivalrous knight does not have these? Now, turn over so I may season your rear.
Oh, wait. For somebody so trained in the culinary craft, I'm shocked you decide to roast me this way.
Uh-oh, she says you can't cook, Grock.
What do you mean?
Well, when you dangle me in such a fashion, the flames will hardly even lick upon my thighs. And the thigh is the most tender and juicy, especially ones such as these.
He does have juicy thighs, Grock.
Be quiet, Sprock. And how do you suggest I roast you?
Over a grate, obviously. That way I am cooked evenly all over. If you undo these bindings, I'll lay out over these cell bars, and you'll be eating a perfectly medium-rare faster than I can scream for the sweet release of death.
Hmm.
Juicy thighs, brother.
Okay. Fine.
Grock reaches up and begins untying Yvain's feet. As soon as they are free, he spins over the spit like a gymnast, launching himself and the beam away from the fire. With great skill, he twirls the spit in his hands and impales Grock through the chest before the troll can react. Sprock begins screaming. Yvain unnecessarily somersaults to the second troll, leaps up, and kicks him into the flames.
Sorry, Sprock, but I like mine well done.
He brushes himself off and walks from the cave as Sprock's screams from the sweet release of death echo through the cavern. Exterior roadside camp, later. Yvain, only in a lane cloth, stealthily dives from a bush back into the camp where he was knocked out. He looks at the dirt, the extinguished campfire, the tracks, investigating.
No surprise. Bandits, most likely. 10 men, 20. Too many to count. Would have to be a lot to get a jump on me.
He touches the unburned logs Kay had been carrying.
And what of my companion, Sir Kay? No sign of him in the cave. Perhaps taken hostage by the gang. Along with my things, stolen from my own sculpted back. Damn them!
Yvain looks to the path in the direction Cal and Kay set out.
Sorry, cousin Cal, but your quest must wait, for nobody dishonors Sir Yvain and steals his armor. I will find these 30 or so thieves and show them the king's justice.
He begins sprinting quite impressively down the road until he steps in a ditch and twists his ankle. Exterior road, day. Cal and Kay ride alongside each other. Kay is still bound, although he rides upright now.
What's in this brooch Lande, anyway?
Haven't been since I was a child, but our parents told us stories of mystical peculiarities and fantastic wonders within. None of it is true, I suspect, but the rumor is that Esclados gains his strength from a magical fountain at its center.
Magical fountain? Come on.
They ride some more. Awkwardly silent.
So, how many more days from Esclados?
Maybe 4 or 5, you know.
You do. You specifically said only I know.
Well, who knows what I may or may not have said?
Me! I was there!
What I'm more interested in is talking about you, Cal. I gotta say, I never knew you had the brawn in you to defeat anything, let alone a giant. Or the brains, for that matter.
I guess that's a compliment?
Absolutely, strong guy. I'm seeing you in a whole new light. Cool, handsome, charming.
Wow. Thanks.
Now, don't mention it, pal. How about you get these annoying ropes off me, and we breeze right on over to the big bad red man's keep like the muchachos we are.
Nice try. And don't think your exotic speech will trick me either.
Not trying anything here, friendo. You know me. Sir Kay is never one to mince words.
You're literally the word minciest person I know.
Okay, that may be true, but I mean it. That guy I saw in action back there, he was pretty spectacular. So what do you say?
Cal considers.
All right. Don't try anything.
He stops and reaches over to Kay. The ropes fall to the ground. Kay stretches.
I was convinced that even a cave troll wouldn't fall for that. Sucker!
Kay shoves Cal, who topples off of Camembert. He grabs his reins and takes off in the direction they came. Cal rolls around on the ground, not yet used to the weight of his new armor.
Have fun storming the castle!
You stupid mincer!
He finally gets to his feet and jumps on Camembert. They pursue. Cal rides Cam as hard as possible, the poor beast struggling to stay on its feet. Surprisingly, the gap decreases. Cal takes a corner a little too widely, and Camembert closes the distance entirely. Cal leaps over to tackle Kay off his horse, but overcompensates. He lands on the ground in front of Kay's horse, which gallops over him with a crunch. The jolt sends Kay flying from his saddle.
I got you.
Cal slowly crawls to where Kay lies on the ground and weakly tackles him.
Get off me, you Neanderthal! Cal, I think you broke my nose.
Touching his nose, Kay winces. Cal climbs to his feet.
Will you stop being such a dillweed?
What?
A dillweed. Which is offensive to a dillweed because that can actually make things taste better. You just sour everything you touch.
A nearby weed, looking suspiciously like dill, wilts.
Whoa, fantastic burn. You scorched me with your dragon's breath.
Shut up!
You're gonna cry.
This whole... I'm such a witty, slick, cool guy. Stick, it's getting annoying.
Well, sorry to disappoint my captor.
Just get me to Esclados and then you're free to go, okay?
Why are you so bent out of shape about fighting the guy?
I'm tired of guys like you making fun of me. Telling me I'm nothing. I just want to show them I can be like Yvain.
But you aren't Yvain. You're just Cal.
As far as anybody is concerned, I'm Yvain as long as I've got this on.
He points to the armor.
So will you please, just give me a break.
Okay.
Huh?
Sure, I'll get you there, willingly. But only to see you crash and burn.
Good enough for me.
You're still a loser, though. Doubt anything will change that.
Cal doesn't respond. He just helps Kay to his feet and they walk back to their steeds. As they're about to get on, Cal turns to Kay.
Oh, one more thing.
What's up?
He punches Kay in his broken nose.
Ah!
Cal gets on and starts riding. Exterior village, day. Cal and Kay ride into a rundown village. Windows are boarded up. Food is circled by flies, and it seems as though everybody is just shoveling slop.
From here, we ride to...
A night approaches!
The villagers all drop what they're doing and turn to Cal and Kay. Their jaws drop.
Good sirs, here to slay the cruel tyrant.
Look at his crest. It's gotta be the noble Sir Yvain we've been hearing so much about.
Wow, this is new.
Strangers rush up to the pair, any and all possessions in their grubby hands.
Please, sirs, have some squirrel jerky for your journey.
Take this goose for luck.
Have my son a squire. I swear he ain't got the plague.
Cal and Kay now hold in their hands loaves of bread, eggs, a sack of meat, tunics, wooden clogs, and a honking goose. A 7-year-old boy sits in front of Cal on his saddle.
She's right, mister. He ain't the plague.
Please, everybody, please.
He
please.
Speaks how he thinks a true knight sounds. It's kind of obnoxious. The crowd silences to listen to the knight. Kay struggles with the rowdy goose.
We are honored by your gifts, but that is not why we come.
All this ain't about taxes, isn't it?
Down with big government.
Taxes? No. I shall slay Esclados the Red and free these lands of his cruelty.
Applause from everyone. A smile creeps onto Cal's face. Kay eyes him suspiciously.
The gifts, my lord, they're thanks for doing so.
You all need them far more than I. Your joy is reward enough.
Oh, for Christ's sake.
Well, if you won't take them, allow us the honor of treating the good sirs to meal and mead.
Any who laugh in the face of certain death at the hands of Esclados the Red sleeps for free at my inn.
Cal gulps.
We really should be going.
Oh, of course.
Okay, we don't have time for a pit stop.
This is literally your only chance to see what it's like to be a knight. These people owe it to us.
I'm not going to take advantage of them, man.
Live it up, just like a real knight would, just this one time, huh?
Oh,
what the hell. One drink wouldn't hurt.
The crowd cheers, and Cal jumps down from Camembert. Kay grins a sly bastard of a grin. Interior inn, evening. Sitting at the bar, Cal and Kay are continuously handed overflowing mugs by their fans.
Another round for brave Yvain.
This is great.
I told you, live the life.
He clinks mugs with Cal as his companion begins to gulp it down. Kay quickly dumps his mead into a nearby plant. The plant sways tipsily, drunk as a skunk.
I want to hear a song.
A minstrel, Jacques, barges through the clumps of drunks to Cal's side. He is young, round, and jolly, a far kinder minstrel than the last one Cal encountered.
Sir Yvain, you asked for a song.
Hmm? Oh, yes, Yvain. You sing?
Yes. My name is Jaques Jahnsen, and I possess the gift of song, my lord. In truth, though, I aspire to be an actor, a traveling jongleur, a troubadour, if you will.
Do you know any songs about me? Do you?
About you? The great Lord Yvain? Of course, I know them all.
He produces a lute from behind his back and plucks a tune.
The greatest knight in all the land, here to give a helping hand to maidens and to damsels near. Lord Yvain has zero fears, his courage is steadfast as rock, and don't forget his mighty...
Okay, I meant to ask, do you know any songs about my cousin?
Your cousin?
He means Sir Cal, the cabbage knight of Arthur's court.
Sir Cal, I don't think so. Wait, I do. Esclados the Red passed through one fine day, when a lone loser Sir Cal came his way.
Okay, enough of that.
No, I want to hear the rest.
Lord, I had no idea Cal was cousin to great Yvain. I guess apples have started falling further from their trees these days, yes?
Kay can't contain his laughter.
Hey now, Cal is a fine knight.
Oh, really? Do tell us more.
Cal taught me, Yvain, everything I know about knighthood. He saved me dozens of times.
Saved the Immaculate Yvain? Now I've got to hear that story.
Cal looks at the crowd, who are all eagerly awaiting to hear from him. It may be the first time in his life that he has been the center of attention.
Well, you see, I had ventured far into the wastelands of Spain.
Spain?
Absolutely. And after traveling for 40 days and 40 nights, I came to a great impasse. A chasm, deep and wide.
Oh, like Jack's girlfriend, am I right?
Shut up, Griff.
So with this chasm... a rattlesnake sprang from the crevice of a rock and gave my steed a terrible fright. I tumbled down into the pit, lost in darkness.
How did you survive?
That's the insane part. Who should arrive but Sir Cal, my incredible cousin, purporting he had felt a murmur of my troubles through some divine communication and rushed to my location in only half the time it had taken me. Wow.
But how did you survive for 20 days without water?
Sorry?
If you fell into a chasm, how did you get water before Cal arrived?
Please, Sir Kay, don't be so pedantic. Well, sweet Jacques, can you spin my tail into a tune?
Absolutely, my lord. In the deep, deep place where serpents lie, poor lone Lord Yvain let out a helpless cry, and who should appear before his very eye but the great Sir Cal descending from the sky.
Cal closes his eyes and listens, smiling. Exterior road, the same time. Yvain marches onward. He's picked up some more scrapes and bruises and is dirty, but he remains persistent. In his hand, he now holds a sharpened spear in place of his missing sword. He freezes, spear at the ready, and investigates a nearby thicket. Pulling back the leaves, he sees the giant, still trapped under the massive branch.
Beast, what happened here?
Not more trouble.
I will bring no trouble if you tell me who came through this pass.
Bad knight one and bad knight two.
Two foul knights, you say?
Those are words I said already.
These knights, tell me of them.
What one smart mouthwise guy.
Likely my quick-witted companion, Kay.
Other Yvain, mean as the average of many numbers.
Mean?
Cruel, lousy, not nice Yvain.
And he told you his name was Yvain?
Yes, I say this twice now.
Damn! The bandits now mar my good name? Bastards!
Help, giant, please.
Yes, clearly you are in pain. Let me provide a mercy for you, fair acquaintance.
Yvain approaches the giant with his spear primed.
Wait, giant not need to die!
Hush now, kind soul. This suffering will all be over soon.
You dance, I'm fine!
Feel pain no more.
He sticks the spear into the trapped giant.
Sleep now, large friend. Find peace.
Was only bump on head. Not serious.
He dies. Yvain kneels at the giant's side. A single tear rolls down his cheek.
Fear not, gentle giant. I shall find whoever did this to you and give them the pain of Yvain.
It begins raining as Yvain yells into the air, enraged. Interior in bedroom, night. Cal stumbles into his bedroom, enthused by the spirits. He hums the song Jacques sang about him and begins removing his armor. When the armor is fully off, laid out on his bed, Cal eyes it proudly, as if it were his own. A knock on the door brings him out of some nightly fantasy.
Come on, Kay. I need to rest before I prove I'm a rad, bad knight, and you kiss my...
He opens the door to reveal not Kay, but Jacques.
Mother! Kiss my mother! She is a kind and affectionate woman who greets everybody with a friendly kiss.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is the Lord Yvain here?
Cal remembers he isn't wearing the armor.
Yes, lad. I am he.
Sorry, my lord. I hardly recognize you without out of the plate.
It's not the armor that makes a knight, son.
Right, of course. I'm sorry to disturb you, Sir Yvain, but I just wanted a private moment to tell you how much your visit means to me.
Oh, don't mention it.
No, my lord, really. When I first heard stories of you, it gave me something to sing about, a reason to try to dig my way out of this town.
Well, I'm happy I could provide that for you.
I'm just curious. My favorite story is when you fought on behalf of the one sister against the champion of the other sister and gave that sucker a good thrashing. I wanted to know, how did you decide who to fight on the behalf of?
Who to fight for?
Yeah. Lord Yvain.
The drinks, they've just gone right up to my head. I guess you can just tell when rescuing a damsel from danger.
Rescuing? Well, the fight was over a minor squabble, though. Remember? They wanted to marry the same fella?
Yes. Of course. The twins.
No, you fought for the younger sister.
Right. Silly me.
Jacques grows very suspicious.
What color was her hair?
Her hair?
Her hair.
Blonde?
You're a liar.
What?
Her hair was red, like your hands, now that I've caught you red-handed. Huh? You aren't Sir Yvain.
Jacques runs from the room.
Wait! Get the torches, everybody! We got a liar in our village!
Interior Kay's bedroom, same time. Kay looks at himself in a stained mirror. He puffs out his chest to look bigger.
Hey, honey. Need a hand? Why, no. I'm not compensating for something. Well, of course, little lady. I can reach that top shelf.
He stops when he hears a growing scream outside his door. Cal runs past the open doorway holding the armor in his hands.
Time to go, Kay!
Immediately after, 10 or so villagers with torches and pitchforks run after him. Kay scrambles about the room, grabbing his things and running after the mob. Exterior village, night. The two knights burst out of the inn. Cal's bare feet sink into the mud. Hopping through the slop, Cal tosses his armor onto Cam's saddlebags and jumps on. He looks to Kay for directions.
Well, which way?
West! We need to go west!
The mob explodes from the inn behind them, about five times larger than before. The entire village, children included, now includes scythes, cleavers, frying pans, wooden spoons, anything they can use to give a good thwack.
Fire!
Damn, these people really hate liars.
The mob gives chase as the two knights ride from the village with haste. The innkeeper tosses their son, who doesn't have the plague, at Cal. He latches onto Cal's back and sticks a knife into the shoulder's back.
Ah! I'll scoop your eyes out, mate!
Kay gives the boy a good, solid, well-deserved kick, and he topples to the ground. The torches of the mob become specks in the distance. Exterior woods, night. Cal and Kay fly through the trees of the nearby woods. Branches whip Cal in the face. They slow their steeds and stop in a particularly shadowy area, one which looks like a prime spot for something bad to happen.
That mob formed stupid fast, like unreasonably so.
I took it off.
Numbskull says what?
The armor. I took it off, and things went to hell.
That's not enchanted armor, Cal. You're a dud with or without it on.
No way, Kay. I'm serious.
Stop trying to be somebody you're not, kid. See what happens when you do?
If I remember correctly, you convinced me to stay for drinks.
Yeah, I'm unwillingly along for the ride of some delusional, deranged, wannabe knight. Might as well have some fun.
When I wear this armor, good things happen. When I don't, bad things happen. It's as simple as that.
Kay starts to wander through the thicket. A fern squirms aside to avoid being stepped on.
Well, oh wise and superstitious sir, best put it on before something else goes awry.
Kay stops wandering, not by his own will, but because his feet are fully stuck in a large, thick web. Web starts circling around his legs from an unseen source.
Cal?
I'm not delusional, man.
Cal, Web!
Cal follows Kay's voice. He finds his companion, who has intense fear in his eyes.
What are you pulling now?
Cal, don't come any...
The web extends to Kay's mouth, and from the shadows, a massive spider leaps towards the two. Grotesque and black as night, the spider is larger than any horse and has dozens of blood-red eyes. Cal is smacked aside by one of the eight hairy legs. The spider wraps around another around Kay and crawls deeper into the woods, Kay murmuring in panic all the way.
See? This is exactly what I mean. No armor, and then this funny bit of business happens.
Cal glances at Camembert, who looks more pathetic than usual.
Oh, I gotta go get him, don't I? Of course, Cam. I know he's the only way to Esclados. Fine! I'll go!
He ties Kay's horse to a nearby tree and then begins putting the armor back on over his tunic and long johns.
Why does every stinking guest nowadays have a giant spider?
Exterior spider lair entrance. Later. Cal and Cam duck beneath some low branches. The deeper into the woods he gets, the spookier his surrounding area. The pair comes to a deep black hole in a rock wall. Webbing creeps around the edges of the gaping opening.
Not terrifying at all. Very relaxing and equally calming, in fact.
Camembert bucks and kicks, struggling from Cal's grasp. The reins slip from his gauntlet and the mule bolts, frightened.
Still definitely not afraid.
He looks at his armor, determination setting in. He slides the visor down over his firm expression, draws his sword, and proceeds. And now we'll be taking a 5-minute intermission. When last we left our heroes, the sly-tongued Sir Kay had been whisked away to a vile spider's lair. The lone loser Sir Cal set off for his pal in for a serious scare. Would Esclados the Red soon lose his head, ending his reign of despair? And brave Sir Yvain left crying in the rain. He'll get his justice, I swear. Interior spider lair, feeding chamber, same time. Kay wakes up. He is tightly bound, stuck to a wall. He tries to squirm free.
Ain't no use, chum.
Kay flinches and struggles to look to his right, where a churl, ugly and filthy, is also bound up. Snot runs from the churl's nose onto his face, which is majority scab.
Excuse me?
No way out but through spider shite. Suppose ain't much other way for me to go. Fella I knew ate it while defecating neath a tree. That is how I want to meet my maker.
Yes, well, I'm a knight, so I'll come up with a way out of this.
Loke over yonder was a knight, too. He didn't get unstuck.
He gestures toward the opposite wall, where a set of armor occupied by a bear skeleton is strung up.
Yeah, been here for many months, seen dozens come and go, and lass eats them all, skin and flesh. Only been surviving off my own scabs for sustenance and the like.
My God, this is how I die, listening to a buffoon.
Interior Esclados' throne room, same time. An Italian envoy in fine garb waits impatiently in the empty throne room. He taps his foot. The envoy jumps when a door opens and a cleaning crew of tongueless servants enters. Lunete, with them, gives direction.
We're going to need all of these curtains taken down. Lord Esclados says he likes a lot of natural light when he drains the life from another man's eyes, so... yeah, Let's take those down, I suppose.
Excuse me.
He approaches Lunete.
I've been waiting to speak with the Lord of the Castle all day now. Prince Giovanni Ragazzi sends me to inquire about the mystical juices.
I'm sorry, Esclados is very busy, man. He'll be with you when he can.
Something about a fountain with the properties of power.
Like I said, this will really have to wait. If I don't get these curtains taken down, it's my head.
He slips into a tirade of Italian gibberish over Lunette's speaking.
Sir, I am very sorry, but there's really nothing I can do. My hands are tied. Not literally, but very figuratively. Who knows what they'd do to me if I tried leaving the service of the Lord and his lady. I mean, these two are a trip, really. You ought to see them when they get going. She's all like, oh, husband, fetch me this impossibly difficult thing to find trinket that I can clean my you-know-who with. And then he is all like, sure, my sweet kiss kitty, but first let me massacre a village of puppies for kicks. Then we'll
She looks up to find the envoy has left during her monologue. If the cleaning crew had tongues, they'd laugh at her.
What are you all looking at? Curtains.
Interior hallway of Esclotus's keep. Continuous. The envoy wanders through the labyrinth of passages in the castle.
Ciao! Hello! Lord Esclados!
Interior spider layer tunnels, same time. Torch in hand, Cal wanders further into the webbed layer of the spider.
Hello? Kay?
Bugs and bones alike litter the sticky surfaces. Begin intercut. A bath chamber. The envoy comes to a door. Steam creeps under it. He knocks.
You may enter.
He goes inside to find a bath chamber, Laudine soaking in the tub. He averts his eyes to be polite.
Excuse me. I was looking for the lord of the castle. I'll just be going.
Nonsense.
Everything she says is over the top. She stands. He does not ogle her bosom.
My lord is out hunting and won't be back for hours. I was just trying some new trinkets.
B, spider lair. Cal slashes through a wall of sticky white string with his sword. The strike lets loose a dangling skeleton which topples onto Cal as though to make love. Blood-red eyes watch from blackness. A, bath chamber. The envoy nervously steps in further, still staring at the floor.
And how may I help you on this lonely night?
My master sent me.
Laudine steps from the tub and slips on a silk robe. B, spider lair. Cal throws the skeleton off him and rolls from the ground. Wisps of silky strands cling to his armor. He turns to look behind him just as the red eyes appear.
Okay.
A, bath chamber. Laudine is circling around the envoy. She traces her finger around his exquisite tunic.
This is fine work. Excellent embroidery.
Oh, grazie, thank you, m'lady.
She pops open a number of buttons. He flinches. B, spider lair. Cal is deeper into the lair, his torch waning, having trouble staying lit. He hears the chatter of two voices, but he can't locate the source.
You'll get used to sawing yourself right in the web if you're here that long.
Buddy, just stop, please.
Bath chamber. Missing his pants, now the Italian is having a difficult time resisting the sultry Laudine.
Signora, per piacere, really, I should go and wait for the lord of the...
Come now. Relax. I don't want to hear another word about that silly man.
She eases on to a dressing bench and beckons to the Italian.
Ah, che diavolo, why not?
He starts to move to the bench when the chamber door is thrown open. Feeding chamber. Kay wiggles his entire body, trying to squirm free. His hands spring out of the sticky trap. He stretches its fingers towards his protruding sword hilt.
Almost got it. Ain't no use. Spintress will have it to break it fast, no doubt of that.
Will you just go ahead and die already?
As if by divine intervention, the spider descends from the lair ceiling and grabs the churl with its yonic mouth. Bath chamber. The envoy gulps as the heavy metal feet slowly enter the room. He glances up at the owner of the feet, Esclados the Red, who grins devilishly.
Lord Esclados, it's not.
He turns to Laudine, who smiles mischievously. He slowly unsheathes his massive sword.
You found some fresh blood, Pumpkin.
Absolutely, Rumpkin.
Oh, figlio di puttana.
See, Esclados' throne room. Lunete directs the tongueless work crew, tired.
Yes, right there. Yes, a little more, yes. Oh, good, that's fine.
She's interrupted by the echo of a particularly Italian-sounding scream.
Oh, shoot. Maybe I should have said something.
B, feeding chamber. The envoy's scream transitions into K's shriek as the Black Widow inhales the churl, who mutters the whole time.
I suppose it's my time. I'll be dying now.
End intercutting. Interior spider lair tunnels, same time. As the scream rings out across the tunnel walls, Cal finally locates the source and charges toward it. Interior spider lair feeding chamber, continuous.
I'm coming, Kay!
Cal runs into the chamber and immediately trips. The sputtering torch tumbles from his hand and into a bedding of web. The spider stops eating. Kay stops screaming. They both look at Cal and roll their eyes.
Oh, jeez.
Great, my hero.
Spitting out the half-eaten churl, the spider turns towards the bumbling knight, preparing to pounce. Still slightly alive, the churl looks down to where his lower half is supposed to be.
Ah, hell, what's the point of living if I can't defecate?
Cal rolls up from the ground and draws his sword, ready to fight the spider, but a puff of smoke wafts into his nose.
Something burning?
Behind you!
Cal turns to see the entire wall of webbing has gone up in flames from his torch. It spreads to where Kay is strung up.
Make this quick, you dick!
Cal and the spider charge into battle. He tries to slash and hack, but his sword won't work on the spider's hide. The sword bounces off easily, and the spider strikes Cal with its leg, sending him into the air.
Parry, Cal, parry!
You don't think I know that?
I know you don't know that!
Cal is on his feet again, trying the same tactic, still failing. Looking to his left, Kay sees the approaching flames. He tries to blow on them. They just increase in size and intensity.
Just accept it, buddy. We're in the same shitter.
Shut up!
Cal flies past again. He crashes into a cluster of spider eggs, exploding spider juices all over him, as he squirms off of the baby spiders, a shadow falls over him. He looks up to see the spider standing directly over him, pincers ready for pincing.
I don't suppose we can talk about this?
It dives for Cal, and he narrowly rolls out of the way. The entire chamber is almost consumed in flames. Over the sound of crackling fire and melting web, the churl can be heard singing a sea shanty as death comes for him.
Cal, cut me down!
Hold on!
Cut me down!
Fine!
He crawls under the spider, emerging behind it, and dives for Kay. And as his sword is about to slash the bindings, a string of web catches it and rips it from his hands. The spider flings the sword into a nearby wall of burning web where it sticks.
Use your teeth!
No way! That stuff came out of
Duck!
Cal ducks as the spider's legs shoot past him. They strike on either side of Kay's head, narrowly missing. Cal lands near the flames. He spots his sword and pulls it from the wall. It emerges wrapped in flame webbing, brilliantly ablaze. Cal swings the burning sword about.
Now we're cooking with gas!
What?
Pretty sure that's an expression.
I have no clue what that means.
Yeah, me neither.
The two return to the moment at hand. Cal dips and dodges the spider and slashes. It squeals as one of its legs come off, the open wound sizzling from the flame.
Yeah!
Kay hides his excitement before Cal notices. Another swing of the sword, another leg shed, a third, a fourth. The spider fumbles around on its four remaining legs, blue blood oozing out of it. Cal sees its faltering strength and goes all in. He runs to the wall and, due to the adhesive nature of the web, runs right up. He, surprisingly coolly, flips off the fiery webbed wall, lands on the spider's back, and plunges the sword into the creature. It lets out a howl and collapses to the cavern floor.
Sorry, webhead. Looks like you spun out.
You've got to be kidding. Hello? A little help?
Oh, right.
Cal runs to Kay and cuts him down, just as the fire is reaching his toes. They move to the exit.
Wait. Your friend.
Friend? Oh, that guy.
They turn and look at the scorched half-corpse of the churl.
He's in the land of losing latrines now.
Kay exits, and Cal follows after him. Exterior spider lair's entrance later. The two emerge into the woods, panting.
I'm gonna be sticky for days.
I'm getting tired of saving you. Can we just find Esclados already?
Yeah. I'd not have been spider snatched if we hadn't been run out of town by your loose lips.
Esclados, which way?
West, yeah, west.
West? You're positive?
Yep, we go about 2 days west, and boom, we're there. Well, that's my horse, but I don't see any...
Camp?
Huh?
Cal spots through the trees his steed, reins tangled in a bush. He jogs towards Cam.
Cam, a bear! I thought he'd run away!
Cal, wait.
He must have waited for me.
Cal, wait!
Cam, good boy, such a good boy.
Something slams into him from behind and throws him to the ground. Cal looks up to see Kay atop of him.
What the hell are you doing?
I said wait.
They start to grapple on the ground, rolling around.
Just listen to me, you idiot!
Kay gets the advantage and pins Cal to the ground. He turns Cal's head so that he can see the tripwire, which leads to a large spiked log suspended in the tree above.
Oh,
We should avoid that.
That's what I've been trying to tell.
The sound of a drawstring being pulled back silences the two.
Evening, boys.
The bickering boys look up to find an arrow aimed at their faces by Elowen, an elven bandit. She looks tempered by years of robbing unsuspecting idiots like the two currently in front of her. In circle formation around the three is an entire gang of bandits, all shapes and sizes.
On your feet.
They slowly rise. Elowen tracks the two with her bow.
Sorry to third wheel on your little date, but we'll be taking the armor and the weapons.
Can we make it 5 minutes without running into another random obstacle?
Sorry, fella, that's just how it goes. Cedric, keep an eye on this one. He looks like a right ass.
Cedric, 7 feet tall and holding a tiny dagger, steps from the ranks and stands behind Kay, who gulps.
Listen, Miss...
Elowen, bandit queen of Bras-le-Lion and surrounding territories, yada, yada, yada.
Why can everybody pronounce that except me? Broiland? Brosaland?
She pulls the drawstring tighter.
Right, get to the point, Cal. Elowen, if you and your...
He looks at the ugly band of misfits.
Fine troop would let me and my companion pass so that we can complete our quest, we would appreciate it immensely.
Appreciation don't fill one's stomach. And I'd wager we could fetch a fancy sum for that plate you're wearing, and those jewels in your sword. So I'll repeat, hand him over.
Okay, just let me stop you there. This armor may look nice, but I guarantee it's just some cleverly placed glitter and knickknacks. Now inside that cave behind us, though, is an entire trove of treasures untold.
I ain't a fool. You don't survive in Esclados land, the Red Domain, very long being a fool, which I'd venture to say you two are.
Esclados the Red, you say?
What of him?
You know him?
Only that he's the meanest bastard to ever live. He's torched every one of our villages, put us in this position. You think we like interacting with the likes of this one?
She points to Kay.
Hey, now I got something to say.
Cedric puts a large hand on Kay's shoulder.
Never mind.
See, the truth of the matter is, we're on our way to kill Esclados at this very moment.
Save your falsities and give me what I asked for, now.
Okay, sounds like a plan.
Cal slowly draws his sword and extends it to Elowen. She lowers her bow and grabs the weapon from his hand, but because of some residue web, it sticks to Cal's hand.
Give it here!
I'm trying, believe me!
The two struggle awkwardly over the blade as Kay and the band of criminals look on uncomfortable.
Would you just let go?
The webbing bond finally gives out, Elowen overcompensates, and the hilt smacks her in the face, knocking her to the ground. As she nurses her nose, Cal eagerly grabs his sword back and pushes it and points it to her chest.
Now the greave is on the other shin!
Cal, aren't you forgetting her?
Boys, kill him!
Oh! Damn.
The gang pounces, weapons drawn, as Cal backpedals from Elowen. He parries blows, ducks swipes, deflects hacking axes. He's getting rather good at this fighting thing. Kay tries to scurry away, but Cedric grabs him, lifts him easily in the air, and tosses him at Cal.
Incoming!
The knights collide, but are quickly on their feet again, both with their swords drawn back to back. For the first time, the two fight together. Sparks fly as steel strikes steel. The clanging of combat rings out over grunts. Elowen fires an arrow straight at Kay, but Cal swings his sword in time to deflect the shot.
Oh my god! That was awesome!
That was freaking incredible.
Right? Thanks!
They turn back to the fight, but are now fully surrounded by bloodthirsty bandits. Cedric readies his tiny dagger. Exterior woods, moments later. The two run, screaming, as arrows fly after them.
I blame you for this!
I accept full responsibility.
Cal leaps onto Camembert and slashes the reins free from their tangle. Kay looks at as the bandits are on their tail. He kicks loose the tripwire, holding the log in the tree line.
Ha! Timber chumps!
As the log drops, Cedric quite easily clutches it and pushes it aside. The bandits seem unaffected.
Let's go.
Cal rides past Kay, grabs his companion, hoists him up, and flees from the bandits. Exterior wooded trail continuous. Cam rides as fast as he can, struggling to carry the weight of the two fully armored knights.
We lose him?
Kay looks over his shoulder. Behind him, the bandits follow on horseback. Elowen leads the pack, arrows primed for night killing.
Not exactly.
Cal looks back.
Where were they hiding those horses?
An arrow whizzes past his ear.
Cam, I really need you to step on the gas right now.
What's with all these gas expressions? I'm lost.
Another arrow. Cam's legs give out. Cal, the ass, and the donkey all tumble off the trail and down a leafy hill. Cal clangs off of trees like a pinball as he tumbles.
No! No!
Exterior bog, same time. Amongst the bubbling mud of a bog, a hermetic old wizard, Tarpan, peruses some fungi. Tarpan wears dirty rags and a rope belt, which jars and bottles of various colored liquids hang from. Twigs stick out of his beard. He hums to himself.
Ah! Copalandia Pavlonakia. Yes, precisely what we've been looking for. Oh, Tarpan, you old sod, you forged a fine batch again. Why, thank you, good chum, enough for both of us.
He looks to his left as though speaking to someone, but he's alone. He plucks some mushrooms, pops a few in his mouth, and drops the rest in a small pouch. As he begins to gather his things, Cal plops loudly into the mud. Tarpan jumps in fright.
Shit!
Kay lands atop Cal with a loud oof. Tarpan jumps more. Nay! A loud donkey bray comes in, and Camembert crashes on top of the knights. Tarpan doesn't jump this time. He just looks at one of the mushrooms in his hand.
They don't usually kick in this quickly. Shh, be quiet, you narc. Sorry.
The three strangers scamper to their feet. The sounds of the bandits can be heard. In a panic, they look at Tarpan.
You, hide us, now.
Interior hermit hole, moments later. The wizard, Cal, Kay, and behind them, sitting crisscross, the donkey, are all crammed inside Tarpan's tiny shack, which is more of like a hole in the ground with branches covering it. They sit as still as stone as the bandits search the area.
They had to have come this way. Find them.
Tarpan looks at Camembert, wide-eyed. Cam looks back. Tarpan quickly looks away, but glances again through his peripherals. He's tripping.
I think I see something on that ridge. Come on.
Cal peeks through a hole in the wall of the shack to see the bandits running past. Their footsteps and voices fade away.
Damn, that was tight. Next time we take my horse to the creepy spider lair.
Okay, I have to ask.
Tarpan points to Cam.
Is this guy also a knight?
Exterior bog, later. Cal stands on a muddy mulch mound, keeping an eye out for the returning bandits. Next to the hermit hole, Kay tries to light a fire. Tarpan sits on the stump, nervously eyeing them.
Can I please stop getting campfire duty?
Cal comes down from his perch.
I think they're gone. You, what's your name?
Tarpan, please don't kill me. I'll give you whatever you want. You need that good stuff? I got jars on jars. No, you knucklehead, don't give him the good stuff. Go to the bad stuff. Duh, obviously I was going to pretend the bad stuff was the good stuff.
We don't need any stuff.
Speak for yourself.
And we aren't here to kill you.
Tarpan is confused, to say the least.
You mean, you don't want to rip my spine from my back?
No.
I'm still deciding.
Esclados the Red didn't send you?
No. You know Esclados?
Former court wizard. His twisted bride didn't think fondly of old Tarpan, so I was exiled. He's out for my head.
We're actually looking for him.
Tarpan tenses up again.
Spies, then?
Can I do the spine thing now?
No, not spies. We're on a quest to find Esclados and kill him. This is Sir Kay, and I'm Sir K... Yvain.
Here we go.
About time someone tried. Won't be so easy enough, though.
Well, why not? He's just a man, right?
No. Not with the fountain of Broceleon.
Not this magic fountain hocus pocus again.
Oh, no hocus pocus here. This fountain is real as can be. It lies within a garden in the center of Esclados' keep.
Interior Esclados' bedchamber. Same time. Esclados lies with Laudine in bed. He brushes her hair aside. They look oddly quaint for once.
When he isn't busy toying with innocence for entertainment, the seriously skewed Lady Laudine, he's drawing strength from the fountain.
Honey bunny, I think I'll help myself to a drink.
He slips from the bed and puts on a robe. Interior hallway of Esclados' keep, continuous. The muscled man marches down a long, dark hallway.
Only he has access to the fount, after he killed the man who previously watched over its mystical waters.
From the end of the hallway, Lunete watches her lord unlock a door. She frowns. Exterior Esclados' dark garden, continuous. He proceeds into a vast, shady garden with full oak trees, mossy growths, bushes. Some lilies hide at the sight of the cruel man, whimpering. In the center of the garden resides a glimmering fountain made of large stones. Water runs into a basin.
Just drinking from its wells fills Esclados with a powerful might, which has allowed him to torment as he has.
Esclados kneels at the fountain and scoops up some crystal clear water. As he drinks, his veins visibly pulse.
Its waters, I've heard, are better than any of my best stuff. And Tarpan stuff is good.
Esclados quivers as though he were on some seriously good stuff. From the shadow of a tree, Lunete watches.
This needs to end.
Like a ghost, Lunete vanishes from the garden. Exterior stables, continuous. She flies into the stable, saddles a horse, and is gone. Exterior bog, same time.
See? I told you it's real.
Still sounds like nonsense to me.
This guy's just tripping balls.
Oh, you'll see when Esclados is sucking the marrow from your bones and Laudine is wearing your skin for a nightie.
Save it, you old kook. We need to be on our way if we're to reach his keep soon.
Son of a bitch, I just got the fire lit.
Kay kicks the logs aside, angrily.
Well, all you need to do is get back on the road beyond these trees and head east for about 2 days. That'll pretty much bring you to his front door.
Kay realizes too late what Tarpan has said.
East? Don't you mean west?
Nothing west but a bunch of trees followed by a bunch of waters.
Cal turns to Kay.
So, why then, Kay? Did you say west?
Well...
What happened to your silver tongue, huh?
It's not what it looks like. I was your hostage anyway.
You're trying to sabotage me! You want me to stay a loser because then you have somebody you can pick on, somebody you can feel superior to, huh? I've noticed a trend. You get captured, you get in a tight spot, and I save you. You're scared that I'm gonna become a better knight than you, is that it?
I'm scared that you're gonna die, okay?
Cal is confused by this.
You're right. I'm not the best knight, and because of that, guess what? You're my only friend. My best friend. And I know Esclados, what he's capable of, what he did to my home. I know there was no way of talking you out of it, but if I kept you away from him as long as I could keep my friend from getting himself killed.
There's a long silence. Tarpan grabs a handful of mushrooms from his pouch and swallows them.
You're wrong about one thing, Kay. We are not friends.
Cal walks towards camp silently, mounts the donkey, and begins to leave.
Cal, where are you going?
East. But by all means, go west. I'll find my own way.
Cal, wait.
It's too late. Cal and Cam have already departed from Tarpan's mud shack.
Cal, what? I thought his name was Yvain.
Exterior woods, same time. In the place where Kay was snatched by the spider, his horse rests, still tied up where Cal left him. A nearby bush rustles and a head pokes out. It is Yvain, looking far less knightly than when he started out. There are deep bags beneath his eyes, and his scruff is not nearly as handsome as before. He rolls from the bush to reveal he is covered in scratches and bruises. Yvain approaches Kay's horse.
Aha! Sir Kay's loyal steed. Left here, all by its lonesome. Curious.
He pets its mane and bends down to examine the tracks in the dirt.
It appears as though it came from over yonder, beyond those trees. And what lies here? A village of fecal farmers? Even more curious. Perhaps one of these poo-pertaining peasants has an eyewitness account of the dastardly bastard who stole my identity. Onward!
Yvain barrel rolls. It was a mistake. He holds his sword back.
Oh, yep. Nope, shouldn't have done that.
He goes back for the horse and takes that instead. Exterior trail, day. Cal rides fiercely, working Camembert to the bone. Because the visor of his helmet is down, you can't see his tears. Exterior bandit camp, day. Elowen examines her bruised nose in the reflection of a stream. Behind her, her men cook rabbit over fires, picking off pieces.
Boss, look!
She wheels around to see a broken Kay wandering through their midst, head down in his own world. He doesn't even acknowledge the cutthroat crooks around him.
He's right, though. You're not a good knight. A good knight wouldn't have lied to his only friend.
What do we do?
Elowen gives it some thought, her hand on her dagger sheathed at her hip. She sees her expression and releases her dagger.
Let him go. We'll find some other fool to hold him up.
Kay ambles out of the camp, entirely unaware. Exterior village, later. Stumbling from the tree line, Kay wanders into the village, head still low. The villagers stop their work and eye him.
What's he doing back here?
He ain't got that other one with him.
The butcher slams down his cleaver and reaches for a pitchfork, conveniently leaning on his stand's wall. A small hand reaches out and stops him. It's the boy, who certainly is plague-free. He shakes his head. Kay finally comes to a stop and looks up. He's standing in front of the inn where, to his surprise, his horse is tied up outside. Kay smiles.
Cal.
Interior inn, same time. Yvain, looking like a crazy man, argues with the innkeeper.
All I ask of you is a place to rest my head and wash my body. Please, kind poor person.
If you don't have the coin, you don't get a room. And he says I'm the poor one.
How about a barter then? The fine knightly steed outside in exchange for some food and shelter.
Mister, there's no horse out there. You sure you're not one of them crazy cannibal folk?
Yvain runs out to investigate. Exterior in continuous. He bursts through the door just in time to see somebody riding east on Kay's horse.
Curses! Duped by these wretches a second time!
Exterior road to Esclodus' keep, day. Hooves pound the ground. Camembert is slick with sweat, but Cal does not relent. As they come around a bend in the trail, Cal almost collides with another person on horseback. Cal bucks, and as Cal hangs on, his visor slides down over his face.
Whoa there, buddy, whoa!
Sir Yvain?
Cal looks up from his steed to see Lunete calming her own horse, staring at the crest on his breastplate.
It is you, isn't it?
Of course. Tis I, Sir Yvain, the great knight. And you are?
Lunete, maiden of the Lady Laudine. Forgive me for startling you. I've recognized your crest from the Raven's message.
Message? Ah, yes, for the duel, which I'm about to engage in with your master, who I am going to kill. And what brings you to this isolated forest passage?
The very same reason you are here, Sir Yvain. This duel, it is a terrible mistake.
Not you two.
You need to listen to me. Lord Esclados isn't just a cruel man. He's also incredibly powerful. Stronger than any man I've ever seen.
And I am Sir Yvain.
He's killed plenty of knights before. Some very good ones, too.
I am no simple knight. I've killed countless ghastly beasts, gained great fortune for my king, and traveled every corner of the known natural world. Surely, that is testament enough of my abilities.
And I'm telling you that his abilities are not of this natural world. He's been—
I'll hear no more of it! I am a knight of the Round Table. I cannot just sit idly by while tyrants torment the helpless and oppress the weak. I am going to kill Esclados the Red, and you are going to take me to him.
Lunete stops herself from protesting. She turns her horse around.
All right, this way. But I can assure you it won't end well.
Exterior forest, day. Yvain limps through the woods, mumbling to himself.
Steal my armor? Fine. Steal my horse? I'll forgive you. Steal my honor? I shall punish without discretion. Nobody makes a fool of Sir Yvain.
A twig snaps and he spins around to find an arrow in his face.
Another knight, eh? You don't look like much.
That may be so, fair dame. But one small lass is no match for—
More twigs snap. Yvain looks around to find he is surrounded by Elowen's gang.
Ah! The villains who pinched my possessions, I assume. Throw up your dukes, fiends!
Cedric, handle this, please.
I'll take your best man and 30 others. Easy! Huzzah!
Cedric emerges from a cluster of bandits. Yvain looks up at the towering slab before he is clocked Cline in the face. The once great knight eats dirt. Exterior Esclados' keep, courtyard, day. Large gates open for an excruciatingly long amount of time, and two tiny specks, Cal and Lunete, ride through.
This is it. Make yourself at home. You don't have long.
Cal rides to the center of the massive courtyard and dismounts. He draws his sword and readies himself. It is as silent as the grave. Not a soul is in sight.
Hello? Sir Yvain has come for the head of Esclados the Red.
Nothing except the echo. Lunete palms her forehead.
Are we gonna duel or what, Esclados?
Yoo-hoo, Sir Yvain. Up here.
In a window high above, Laudine leans out, waving a silk kerchief.
Come up here for a drink, why don't you?
I'd just really like to get to this duel and all. Is Esclados around?
Nonsense. Come, come.
Interior Esclados' bedchamber, moments later. Laudine opens the door. Perplexed, Cal steps in. Laudine goes to her bed and sits on the edge, legs crossed.
So you're the great Yvain I've been hearing so much about?
Yes, my lady. Is your husband
here? I don't want to hear any more about that man, but you... I've heard lots. And let me put it this way. I'm intrigued.
Intrigued?
Very.
She rises and starts circling Cal, running her hands along his armor.
Sir Yvain, the brave, noble knight of Camelot. Are the legends true?
Laudine undoes a clasp on the breastplate.
I think I really should just be getting to fighting your husband now, if that's all right with you.
Another clasp undone. The plate falls to the floor. Cal is frozen in place, too uncomfortable to do anything.
What did I say about him? No more.
She reaches for Cal's helmet, but he lifts his hands to stop her.
Oh, save it for last. I like the way you think.
The faint rumbling of horse hooves can be heard outside. Cal's gauntlets are on the floor now. His sword clangs to the ground next.
That must be him. So, I better get ready to kill him.
Not so fast, sir.
She pushes him down onto the bed and rips off his boots and greaves. Interior stairway, same time. Esclados' spur boots march up a stone staircase with haste. Interior, Esclados' bedchamber, same time. Cal, now in just his underwear and helmet, lies frozen on the bed. Laudine looks at his relatively schlubby, unmuscled physique with disappointment.
It's fine. It doesn't matter. Now, for the final piece.
Really, this is a bad idea.
As the footsteps in the hallway grow nearer, she reaches up to the helmet and removes it. The face is familiar to her. It takes a moment.
You? You're not Yvain.
The door flies open and Esclados is outlined by the frame. Laudine leaps from the bed and screams at Cal. Esclados looks at Cal and immediately recognizes him.
What is going on here?
This depraved pervert snuck in and tried to seduce me while you were out hunting.
Didn't ogle enough bosom last time, you insect.
Cal scrambles for his sword. Laudine kicks it away from him. He looks to his scattered armor and starts to sweat. Before he can react, Cal is lifted into the air. Esclados firmly grips his neck.
This is good, though. I regretted not killing you last time, and my hunt did little to placate me.
You show him, Fudge Nugget.
He won't be forgetting his lesson, Smoochy Bear.
Esclados tosses Cal with ease, and he tumbles backwards out the window. Exterior Esclados' keep courtyard continuous. As Cal falls, he closes his eyes, certain he is about to expire. With a thud, he hits a wagon full of hay and bounces out onto cobblestones.
My God, are you all right?
Lunete rushes over to Cal and rolls him over.
Sir Yvain, Cal? What are you doing here?
Night stuff, you wouldn't understand.
I understand you want to get yourself killed.
Lunete is easily pushed aside and replaced by Esclados, who picks Cal back up.
It seems luck is your only skill. You can't avoid death forever, you insignificant oaf.
My lord, he's just a nobody.
Thanks a lot!
Please let him go.
Really, give it to him!
He won't be getting away this time.
Esclados hoists Cal up into the air and punches him in the face. He tosses a bloody Cal into the dirt and draws his sword, preparing to thrust.
Get away from him!
Kay dashes in atop his horse and dives from the saddle, tackling Esclados. The two struggle and Kay holds Esclados' face in the dirt, Big Brother style.
Cal, run!
This way!
Lunete pulls Cal up and drags him nearly unconscious towards a grate in the ground. She lifts it open and pushes Cal inside. A loud splash is heard below. She follows and closes the grate behind her.
Get off of me, you knave!
Esclados, done toying around, tosses Kay to the side and looks around for Cal.
You won't be killing him today, jackass.
You'll do for now.
He kicks Cal in the face, knocking him out.
Bring him to the dungeon.
A nearby servant perks up.
Who, me?
Yes, you. Who else is there?
Exterior riverbank. Day. In the rushing, poo-filled waters emerging from the sewers of Esclados' keep, Cal bobs limply onto the shore. Lunete swims after him and drags him fully from the river's waters.
Are you okay?
He opens his eyes and coughs some water into her face. He curls into a fetal position.
Leave me alone.
I need to see if you're hurt.
Just leave, okay?
Lunete begins to walk away, head hanging.
Why did you save me? I'm not worth saving.
Because I can tell you'll make a good knight. Because you can't just give up.
Why? Weren't you the one who told me I didn't stand a chance?
That was when I thought you were Yvain.
And I'm not him. Without his armor, I'm a nobody. You said it yourself.
What happened to not letting cruel men oppress the poor and the weak and all that? You're content to let Esclados do that to your friend now, too?
I lied, okay? I'm a fake. I'm not that knight.
You're right. That knight wouldn't leave his friend to die. His friend who came back for him.
She starts walking away again. He's hit with a wave of realization and he stands.
Wait! I'm gonna need your help.
Exterior bandit camp. Night.
You're gonna need all the help you can find when I free myself from these bindings.
Yvain, tied to a tree, squirms about. Elowen's merry band of thieves sit around a fire, laughing and drinking.
Keep jesting. Keep jesting with your libations, but any who wrong the great Sir Yvain will surely know his pain.
Cedric, shut him up.
Cedric approaches, knuckles primed.
Please don't hit me again.
Instead, Cedric gently places a burlap sack over his head and returns to the fire.
Trespasser spotted!
The gang jumps up from their meals and draw their weapons as Cal walks into the camp.
Come back for more, huh?
Came back with a deal.
We ain't in the business of making deals with stuck-up nobles and the like.
I think you'll want to listen. Esclados, he took your lands from you. I want to get them back.
Elowen looks for a tell, if he's bluffing. When she finds none, she sheathes her dagger.
All right, we'll hear you out.
Fantastic. Follow me.
He walks from the camp and the bandits look at each other, perplexed.
Well, what are you runts waiting for? Let's see what the man has to say.
They follow Cal, leaving behind burning embers and a bound Yvain.
Hello? Treacherous bandits? Are you still there?
A bear wanders into camp and starts sniffing Yvain.
Cedric, you hound, you can't scare me.
Exterior, Esclados' gate, morning. A large wagon arrives in front of Esclados' keep. It is brightly colored with a patchwork canvas of reds and blues, streamers hanging from either side. In the front of the wagon, reins in hands, is Jaques, singing a hearty road song. The guard at the gate halts him.
Oh, state your business. We are but a jolly troop of jongleurs, looking to sing our songs and act our acts. Will you allow us to enter so that we may perform for the mistress Laudine?
A troop?
Aye.
Cedric, in jester costume and makeup, leans out from the back of the carriage. He grunts. A second guard pops out on a distant wall.
Oi, who is it?
A bunch of circus freaks. They want to see Lady Laudine.
Why?
Why? Well, we've traveled the lands looking for the most beautiful ladies to write our ballads about. We've heard none rival Laudine of Landuc. It says they want to write songs about Lady Laudine having a banging bod.
Hold on a second.
He disappears. Jaques and the guard sit in silence waiting.
She says send him on in.
The guard opens the gate and the wagon passes through, revealing in the back Cal, Lunete, Tarpan, Elowen, and all of her bandits in matching jester's outfits and fake beards. Tarpan wears a beard over his beard. Exit Esclados' keep courtyard later. Cedric drops a crate of props, bells, balls, balloons, boinkers, bonkers, bamboozlers, and so on, onto the ground. The armored liegemen cautiously eye the performers who set up, laying out platforms for a stage, hanging banners.
No, Cedric, stage right. That's house right. Am I the only one here with any theater experience? We are actors, people.
Elowen and Cal walk over to the crate and examine it.
Everything is in place then?
Damn right. Once the show begins, they won't even know what hit them.
She lifts a set of bells from the crate to reveal a stash of swords and bows beneath.
Perfect. We wait until Esclados is vulnerable, okay? Nobody drops the act until I give the signal.
Sure thing, Cal. You're the knight after all.
She rolls her eyes and joins her men in setting up. Cal returns to the wagon. Lunete hides inside.
Everything's ready. Now, let's hope these misfits can put on a good show long enough.
He looks over to see Tarpan eating a handful of dirt. The wizard, who approves, sticks the rest up his nose.
A good enough show.
Please be careful, Cal. This won't be easy.
I know. And, Lunete, I...
A trumpet blares, and Laudine walks from the keep with her handmaidens into the courtyard, taking a seat in one of the two ornate chairs.
Well, dazzle me.
Showtime.
Exterior, Esclados' keep courtyard moments later. Cal, now wearing a jingly jester's hat and a tragedy mask, and the bandits take center stage. Tarpan drops some dry ice into buckets, and the stage fills with fog. Cal notices the empty chair next to Laudine.
Wait, where's Esclados?
For God's sake, is that all anybody ever asks me? Where's Esclados? Will the Lord be here soon? Should I prepare for a second dinner plate for your husband? He'll be along shortly. Just get on with it.
Your time to shine, Jaques. All the greats got their starts like this. Come on, you can do this.
Elowen strums out a beautiful note on a harp. Cedric looks at Elowen as though she's a complete stranger.
What? I wasn't always a bandit.
Jaques begins singing along with the harp. It's a lovely ballad until the bandits join in backup. The opener breaks out in what is supposed to be a swing dancing number. The bandits step on each other's feet, Cedric stands completely still in his mark, and nobody can carry a tune. As the song ends on a horrid chord, Tarpan throws down some pyrotechnics which just fizzle out instead of shooting flames. The performers hit their pose and hold it. Only one person claps, the gate guard. Laudine glares at him.
Sorry, m'lady. Thought it was a comedy bit.
As they prepare to begin their next number, a posse of men march out from the castle surrounding Esclados. Attached to a chain in his hand is Kay, beaten and bloody.
Kay. Oh, jeez.
Cal looks at Elowen and nods. Esclados takes his seat, pushes Kay to the ground, and kicks up his feet, using him as a footrest.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the famed dancer of unknown lands performing the dance of the dunce, Duke Ding Dong.
Duke Ding Dong?
It's improv, baby. You're supposed to say yes and.
He begins strumming, and Cal is pushed to center stage. He stumbles out, looks at the crowd, gulps, and begins interpretive dancing. It's rather good. Cal moves like liquid across the stage, gracefully wowing the spectators. Once he's won them over, he steps down from the platform and approaches the guests of honor. Laudine gasps as Duke Ding Dong leaps around her chair. He then moves onto Esclados and gyrates in front of him. The crowd chuckles, but a look from Esclados silences that quickly. Cal circles around to the back of Esclados. As Cal dances, Esclados notices the stubby wizard by the buckets of ice. Something's familiar about him. He rises.
Hold on a minute.
Now!
Before Esclados can react, the bandits leap from the stage, hidden weapons brandished.
Men, to arms!
His liegemen erupt from their station, swords drawn, and they begin engaging the bandits. Kay looks up from his perch.
Who the...
Cal removes his mask and winks.
Hold tight, Kay. All damsels need saving once in a while.
You stupid, pathetic fool. This time, I'll crush your skull under my boot.
Esclados swings his sword, but Kay yanks on the chain just in time, swerving the attack. It narrowly misses Cal, who leaps for the crate of weapons. He draws and faces a soldier.
Do your worst!
The soldier laughs. Kay looks down at his hand, which holds a rubber chicken. He tosses it at the soldier, who bats it aside.
Hey, ugly!
Jaques jumps up behind the soldier and smashes his loot over the thug's head. It lets out a cacophonous noise.
Music to my ears.
Cal grabs his sword and dives into the fray. He searches for Esclados. Amidst the chaos, Elowen places arrows in knees, ribs, buttocks. The bandit are holding their own. Tarpan tosses smoke bombs all over. He looks at Cal and points.
Cal! He's making a run for it!
Across the battlefield, Esclados drags Kay through a doorway. Cal runs after, but is halted when Laudine leaps onto his back and chomps down on his ear.
Ah!
If my husband won't do it, I will.
She scratches at his face, claws at his neck.
Lady! I can't fight a lady!
Oh, you'd like to, wouldn't you, you sick freak?
She bites down again, and Cal jerks his head back instinctively, bashing her nose.
Oh, I am so sorry. Are you all right?
Without responding, she starts beating on Cal, but is yanked off by Lunete.
Cal, go!
Lunete, what are you doing?
I quit.
You can't quit. You're indentured.
Oh, well,
Lunete decks her former lady in the face. Cal nods to his companion and runs after Esclados. He signals to two bandits.
You two, with me.
Exterior Esclados' garden, moments later. Cal and his backup emerge into the shady garden, ready to fight. Esclados stands in the center by his fountain. Kay lays at his feet.
You've got a death wish, boy.
You've got a death fish?
What?
I don't know. I'm not great at improv.
The two bandits charge at Esclados and are both quickly dispatched. He laughs.
I must say, you do at least look more knightly this time around.
Cal looks at his jester costume, his jingling hat.
I don't need armor to beat you.
It's a shame only your friend is here to see you die.
Cal beat this poser's ass back to the late antiquity period.
Esclados dashes for Cal and the two connect. Swords bounce off each other. Strikes, parries, rolls, and dodges. The two engage in an epic battle. Cal lands a strike on Esclados' arm, and the tyrant staggers back. He looks at the blood dripping from his arm, shocked.
You're not so invulnerable after all.
Neither is he.
Esclados plunges his sword into Kay, who goes limp.
No! Kay!
Oops. Guess he won't get to see you die.
Cal runs to his friend, but Esclados swats him aside and his sword scatters into some bushes.
As usual, Sir Cal, you are a lone loser.
You dickweed.
There are no dickweeds to react to this, thankfully. Esclados charges again, and Cal rolls behind a tree. When Esclados turns around, Cal is gone. He begins circling around the fountain, out for more blood.
See? You're nothing but a coward hiding from battle.
Jingling bells alert Esclados, who swings at thin air.
And you're a bully who slaughters the weak and calls it sport.
Too scared to face me yourself? It's not like you have a reputation on the line.
He swings at bells again, but hits nothing.
Stop these games.
You don't get it, Esclados. I'm not playing around anymore.
Am I supposed to be scared of you? An inconsequential nobody who is so unknown he's practically invisible?
Esclados spots a bell sticking out from behind a tree trunk. He smirks.
Fat chance.
He swings and takes the jester hat clean off.
What?
Of a head of cabbage. Cal leaps from above onto Esclados and knocks him down. Esclados rolls out from under his attacker and dives towards him, but Cal has already grabbed Esclados' sword. Esclados the Red dives directly onto his own sword and slides down the blade on top of Cal. He coughs up blood.
Oh, shit. Tell Esclados the Yellow he's top dog now.
He dies, his weight falling on top of Cal. Cal struggles to squirm out from under the body and rushes to Kay's side.
Come on, Kay, come on!
He shakes Kay, but nothing. He's gone incredibly pale.
Don't do this to me, man!
Cal looks up at the fountain in front of him.
You better not have been mincing words about this damn fountain, Kay.
He drags his friend to the fountain and rolls him into the clear waters. He sits there, holding Kay, waiting for something to happen.
Come on! I can't lose you, Kay!
Kay lays still, and Cal buries his head in his hands.
Well, if you like me so much, why don't you marry me?
Kyle has no words. He just hugs Kay.
You really did it, huh?
I couldn't just leave you.
You're my best friend.
No, you're my best friend.
No, you're...
Why don't we get out of this spooky-ass garden, huh?
Yeah, there might be some giant spiders lurking about.
Cal helps Kay out of the fountain, and the two limp from the garden. Exterior is Claudius's keep courtyard. Moments later, the two emerge into the courtyard where Elowen and her gang are finishing up dealing with Esclados' liegemen. Lunete runs up to the beaten pair and helps Cal with Kay.
Is it done?
Let's just say I wished him a good night.
Yeah, I don't know what that means. Is Esclados dead?
Yes. Dead.
Smooth.
Very dead.
Smooth. Slick.
Thanks, Stretch. And what about Laudine?
She's a bit... preoccupied for the moment.
Across the courtyard, Laudine is strung up in the stable. Camembert reaches across the gate and nibbles on her hair.
Let me go, you stupid ass.
Hey! Be nice to Camembert.
Before more congratulations can commence, the castle gate swings open. Everybody freezes. A creature in the shape of an enormous bear lumbers through and slows to a stop. The bear fur drops off, revealing Yvain, with claw marks all over.
All right, but Esclados talk. Esclados, but Duke's in a... fighting! Fight!
He takes another step and passes out into a mound of manure.
Oh, right. We left him tied up.
Whoops.
Yeah, same here.
Elowen signals to some men and they go to aid Yvain. As the heroes start cleaning up the battle, servants and commoners emerge from hiding places.
Is the Lord dead?
Are we free now?
The good knight done it!
A small girl approaches Cal and reaches for his hand.
Sir Knight, what's your name? So I can thank you for helping us.
Cal looks to his cousin, being dragged from the slop and onto a stretcher all because of him, and sighs.
Yvain. Sir Yvain defeated Esclados the Red.
Sir Yvain.
The crowd begins chanting Yvain's name, and even though they aren't saying, Sir Cal, Sir Cal, Sir Cal, it's enough for him. He smiles. Interior Esclados' Great Hall, night. Jacques' melodies fill the air for a celebration. Commoners feast on Esclados' stockpile of foods. Cal sits in the back corner with just his friends and allies, away from the party. Yvain, bathed in bandage, his arm in a sling, walks to where his cousin sits.
Little cousin, seems perhaps you are not so little after all.
Thanks, Yvain.
I'm done. I'm not done. I misjudged you, Cal. You are brave and strong. Defeating Esclados the Red? No small feat.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm pretty certain all the legends will say it was Sir Yvain who did all that stuff.
Perhaps my cousin is the better man than I.
With his broken arm, Yvain slaps Cal on the shoulder, which causes Cal a great deal of pain.
Ow! That didn't hurt you at all?
Not in the slightest.
Yvain grabs a mug of mead and gulps it down.
Ah, peasant drink. Wild stuff.
He waltzes off into the throng of meetings of maidens to mingle.
Never gets old of that guy.
Tell me about it.
Aha! I have the courage of panther and the Johnston of a stallion. Huzzah!
The two laugh.
Follow me. I want to show you something.
He gets up and walks from the hall before Cal can respond. Cal shrugs and follows. Interior armory, night. The friends arrive in Esclados' armory, a little drunk and in high spirits.
That fountain really did the trick.
Told you it wasn't just hocus pocus. I'm still waiting for some crazy powers of something, but nada.
He leads Cal to a sheet covering a mannequin.
But check this out.
Kay pulls the sheet off, revealing a beautiful set of silver armor as regal as Yvain's, but with a cabbage crest on the breastplate. Cal is speechless.
Turns out Esclados' blacksmiths are pretty damn good. Had him whip this up for you.
Kay, I don't know how to thank you.
No need to. All great knights need a good set of armor.
Cal hugs Kay. It's really extended.
Yep, yeah. I really still like that song, though. How's it go? It ended with Cal on his lone loser ass.
Shut up.
He playfully punches Kay. Exterior, Esclados' keep courtyard morning. Before the sun has even come up, Cal, in his new armor, leads Camembert from the stable and saddles up the mule. He's about to mount his steed when...
Where are you going?
Cal looks to Lunete, who brushes her horse nearby.
What are you doing up?
Lady Laudine had me brush her hair for an hour every morning. Old habits die hard and such, so I had to find something to brush. And you? Off so soon?
I'm sure there are other quests out there that need questing. It's time I found one of my own.
What about the castle? There's no lord now, and these people will need a good one.
I'm not the guy for the job. Besides, if it weren't for you, I'd still be lying in a ball on the riverbank back there. How about you?
Me?
Yeah. You could be lord, or lordess, I guess. Is that proper? No, it's, saying it now sounds really wrong. Just lord. I better stop while I'm ahead.
I don't know if I can do it by myself, Cal.
You've got everything you need right here.
He points to Elowen and her men, sleeping happily drunk around the courtyard.
Soldiers?
He points to Tarpan, dangling upside down from the stable rafters like a possum.
A wizard?
He points to Lunette.
Sort of. And a strong leader.
Thank you, Sir Cal.
She gives him a kiss on the cheek. The conversation has started drawing some people from their slumber, and a small group emerges from the keep.
Time I got going then.
He mounts Cam and spurs him towards the gates. Exterior, Esclados' gate continuous. The crowd, Kay amongst them, stands in the gateway as they watch Cal ride away. Interior, Esclados' bedchamber, same time. Yvain wakes from his first good sleep in days in an unfamiliar bed. He looks to his left to see Laudine sleeping soundly next to him.
I won't ask.
Laudine fell madly in love with Sir Yvain. Definitely not just for his looks and status. Once she realized he was just a bag of bricks, though, too dense for her to effectively manipulate, she began devising various ways to fall out of love. One may have involved burning somebody at the stake.
Yvain rises and walks to the window where he sees his cousin in the distance, riding from the castle.
Farewell, little cousin, and Godspeed. Yvain enjoyed his new life of peaceful prosperity in the countryside with Laudine, but soon grew restless. He set out on a quest to relive the glory days, promising, "Babe, I'll be back so soon, I swear." Instead, he lost his mind in the desert, became best friends with a lion, kissed a dragon to turn it back into a maiden, and a ton of other dumb shit before he regained his mind. Or perhaps he never did regain his mind.
Exterior, Esclados' gate, same time. Lunete looks fondly after Cal, riding away, and waves. The people around her follow suit.
Lunete was adored by all of her subjects during her time as ruler of Broceliand. She led the people with great dignity and compassion, a breath of fresh air after Esclados' reign of being an asshole. People toasted to her often, at least for the next 2 months until her early demise by the plague, which she certainly didn't catch from taking the son of an innkeeper as her squire.
Kay sadly looks at his friend, riding away without saying goodbye.
Wait, he's stopping! He's coming back!
Cal trots up to Kay.
Well, you coming or what?
Hell yeah.
Kay mounts his horse and grins a huge boyish grin.
After various adventures with Cal, Kay decided that perhaps knighthood wasn't the best use of his silver tongue, and he soon quit the round table.
Kay took to a nomadic lifestyle of touring taverns and inns across the world, sharing jokes and quips. He adopted the moniker Louis C.K. and became the world's first stand-up comic.
Let's go, friend.
They begin to ride from the castle. Cal smiles at his best friend.
Confident with himself for the first time, Sir Cal the Cabbage Knight soon set out in search of his king's most desired treasure, the Holy Grail. During this quest, Cal encountered two sibling knights fighting over a woman. Being the kind soul he was, Cal intervened and as a result was brutally murdered by one of the brothers. Moments later, God reached down from the heavens, calmed the brothers, and revealed the location of the Grail. It was under a rock that Cal's corpse was lying atop. Sir Caligrenant's main legacy is the origin of the common phrase, bros before hoes.
Exterior hilltop, morning. The two best friends ride together into the distance atop their steeds as the sun rises on another day. The end.